Well, it's been quite a while, I think, since I've seen a lot of you. It's wonderful to be back here. I've known many of you for my entire life, literally. When I started to prepare, I was reading this Bible from 1994. Thank you very much, Tom. Who has given me this and written in front. So if you've read any of the updates that have been in your newsletter, you'll know that I grew up with the Baptist from the start with Bruce for a while there, and then a few years back, I went over to the UK, and I went to a church called Holy Trinity Bolton in London, and did a worship training course there. And then about a year ago, I moved the team to Birmingham, which is 2 hours north of London, out in the Midlands, which is an area that typically doesn't have the best reputation, but it's a very large university student area. And we've planted this church with the heart to reach a lot of university students and to see the gospel preached and shared and life brought amongst university campuses and, of course, the wider community. Because there's 70,000 students, the role that I've sort of taken on is to really head towards reaching university students. And so I've just been volunteering at this church plant for the last year. But then in September, I'll start being paid 2 days a week to do student ministry. We have over 100 students that have connected with the church already. In September, there'll be a whole new year of university students coming in. And I'll also be overlooking an internship program that the church is starting with worship and kids ministry and young adults ministry. So I'll be sort of overseeing those 5 interns. So that's just a bit of an update about what I'll be doing in the coming years. I've got a 3-year ministry of religion visa that I'll be returning on. And just again, thank you so much for your love and your support. It's been an incredible journey to share with you across the sea, the family that loves and cares. It's incredible. So let's get into our passage, which was so wonderfully read before. Thank you all for that. So, I'll just pray before we read. Father God, just open our hearts to see the truth, to see what it is you can speak into us this morning. We thank you so much for your word, and for your spirit which takes your word and applies it to our hearts and shows us the truth. Holy Spirit, we open our hearts, we apply this word to us right now to see more of who Jesus is and who we are in light of that narration. In your name, amen. So, 1 John 5. Shall we put it back up on the screen? Is that possible? Or otherwise, you might have a Bible or a little miniature screen in front of you. 1 John 5. Page 1228 for me. I don't know if that's the same for you. Might give you an idea of where to go. Near the end, it's in the right. So, 1 John 5, verses 1 to 5. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. This is love for God, to obey his commands. And his commands are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Wow. It's kind of a very typical Joel thing to have so many words and so many themes, and it kind of runs backwards and forwards and crosses over itself, this passage. But I think it's very important to consider who has written this, what was his journey, and therefore, in light of John, what does that say about our passage this morning? Because this was written by the disciple whom Jesus loved. What a neat name he gave himself. I'm the one Jesus loves. The disciple John. For years, I thought it was John the Baptist. I was very confused. And then I would read how John the Baptist got beheaded. And I was like, this doesn't add up. Something's not right. How do we finish this book without a head? That doesn't make sense. And then I realized, there's two Johns. John the Baptist and John the disciple whom Jesus loves. This is John the disciple whom Jesus loved, who also wrote that gospel of John. And for John, I think there are a few themes and truths that really resonated in his heart, that really changed who he was. And therefore you see that reflected in the Bible. Neat themes are more than just themes, they're truths about Jesus Christ, who you knew, who you walked on this earth. And you see that reflected. And I think we need to go back a little bit to his gospel and see some of those first encounters that he had with Jesus that I think in our passage today, he's expanding upon them. He's unpacking those ideas a little bit more here. These truths ran through John because he found them in relationship with Jesus. And I think it's these three things particularly. Jesus brings rebirth. Jesus brings love, and Jesus brings victory. There's three things. So the first one, Jesus brings rebirth. So the first three verses, you see this idea that anyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is what? Born of God. So where else can we think about John speaking of being born? Well, if we go to his gospel, chapter 3, Nicodemus comes to Jesus by night. And he says, I know that you're a man of God, but I'm still going to come at night, and I'm just secretly confident to see you. So maybe they don't believe it quite as much. And Jesus is like, all right, let's cut to the chase. Unless you were born again, you're not going to receive the kingdom of heaven. And of course, Nicodemus is like, well, what are you going on now? And I mean, fair enough, what on earth does that mean? How on earth do you describe the spiritual transformation that Jesus brings? What do you do? Any language really falls short. Exactly, I demonstrated that. In the passages that you must be born, this little Greek word, anothen. And it can either mean born again or born from above. And I think the little word actually means both. You have to start again from above. And when he says born again, Nicodemus is like, what on earth are you talking about? How can I crawl back into my mum's womb? I don't think either of us want that to happen. What on earth does that mean? Do I need to start again? And Jesus is like, yes, start again from above. That's exactly the point. But it's kind of, it's that spiritual rebirth thing. So the first birth that we had into the world was born into a world of slavery, of sin, and of brokenness. And so we totally need to start again. But now it's from a different source, not just in flesh and blood, but of the Spirit of God, who brings transformation in our hearts. And so that first birth, born into slavery, second birth into freedom, into a spiritual freedom, born by the Spirit, born of God, again, literally begotten of God, the offspring of God. So no wonder Nicodemus is so confused, and I'm sure after time, more clarity was brought to John as to what this rebirth meant. Which is what I think he's doing, he's unpacking this a little bit more. So we're told that we need to be born again from above, we need to start over. Well, how does that happen? And the answer here, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. That's how you start again from above, by believing that Jesus is the Christ. You were born again. And was anyone particularly active in their own birth? I wasn't. I was very passive in this. It's not something that we can do or achieve for ourselves. You're born again from above. Why? By believing that Jesus is the Christ. That's how. I, a few years back, bought a MacBook Pro. You know, the laptops, the overpriced silver ones with a little apple on the front of it. And from day dot, this thing was a pile of junk. So I open it up and take probably 2 minutes before I type my login. then it would crash again, and then it would wake up again, and I'd have to type in the login. And so it would probably take me about 5 minutes before I could actually start using my computer. And all these people going on about how great Macs are, and I was like, I'm not seeing it right now. My pen and paper is way quicker. And so I took it into what they call the Genius Bar, which is, if you've ever been to an Apple store, and there's people at the back, they're all these experts. So I took it in there, they ran all these diagnostics, and they said, oh yeah, we need to do some, you know, learning smart person thing. I was like, okay, do that. Take it home, open it up, exactly the same problem. Took it in again, and changed another learning thing, exactly the same problem. And I thought, this is just not good. Spoke to my mate, Wes, who's a genius at all these things himself. And he said, we just need to start again. Start all over. Just swipe everything, install, brand new hard drive, download all the operating system, start again. And now, ding, straight away, log straight in, good as gone, good to go. I think that's, of course, this is a poor analogy, but that's kind of the idea of the rebirth, isn't it? That oftentimes in our life we go to these so-called genius bars and these places, try to look for the hope, look for the new direction, look to the new birth, and it just hasn't worked. We've had the same old problems at login that we've always encountered. It's only until you get a fresh restore of everything from Jesus that things start to work again. Once you've been reborn from above by believing in Jesus who is Christ. So what does Jesus do? He brings rebirth and he brings love. He says, everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. And this is love for God, to obey his commands. If you've ever read Chapman's 5 love languages, what is it? There's quality time, physical touch. What else is there?
Words of affirmation.
Acts of service. Gifts. That's the other one. I've heard it said, God's love language is obedience. It's obedience. This is love for God, to obey his commands. What's his command? Well, again, if we're looking at somewhat of the journey of John, his experiences of Jesus, what has Jesus said previously about love? Well, if we go to the upper room at the Last Supper, just before Jesus is about to be crucified, what does he say? A new command I give to you, that you love one another as I do. And this is how everyone will know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. What I really loved is when I was walking in, there was a sign out the front that said, you know, turn back and go up and around the stairs. And that said, I think it was, we endeavor to be a church who supports one another through everything in life. Words to that effect. Did you know what I'm referring to? On that sign? Well, if you haven't read the sign, just come in and go and have a look. But I just thought that was beautiful as I was thinking about this passage of being called to love one another. It said that we're going to support one another through whatever we face in life. That's love. That's the new command that I've given to you, to love one another. And that's how people will know, as they walk past, read the sign, and then feel your love in this community. That's how they know that you're a disciple of Jesus. And I think that's a great question we all need to ask ourselves. How do people know that I'm a disciple of Jesus? How do they know? For me, if I'm traveling around on a train, and someone asks me, what do you do? And I say, oh, I'm a pastor. Is that how they know I'm a disciple? Or is it because of how I love and how I interact with them, seasoned with grace and love of Jesus? Is it because of the things that I stand against or protest? Is that how I know that I'm a Christian? Because Christians are the ones who pick it? Or is it because of my love and the grace and the kindness that I show? How is it that people know that I'm a disciple of Jesus? My, a lot of you will know my eldest brother Clinton, and then my sister Natalie. So, recently, which one came first? Eloise or Renee? very wonderful of me. Renee. Okay, so my sister had her third child, and then 2 days later, my brother had his first child.
With his wife.
With his wife. Yes. He's just out of order, though. And I don't know, is there a collective term for nieces and nephews? Is there a collective thing? Nephi?
Chaos.
Chaos. Until I had my own chaos, I've never really known that kind of relational love thing that you get from someone that is of your own flesh and blood. And I remember my little niece Danny holding her in my arms just after she was born and thinking, there's kind of no reason that I would love you. You're just kind of small and cute. But because I love your sister, and because you're part of my tribe, I love you so much. Like, you've earned nothing, you've done nothing, you've just kind of sat there looking all small. And I just super, super love you right now. So much. What does he say? Everyone who is born of God is our brother and sister. And we love them. Why? Because we love the Father. We share a relative. We share the Father. And whenever I'm holding these little ones, I'm like, I love my brother. I love my sister, therefore. I love you so, so much. And it's kind of different at times with other people's kids, isn't it? Like, they're super cute and lovely and all the rest. But I mean, I was at a wedding recently, and so, you know, we're all dressed up, and I had my, you know, suit off. And one of my friends had a newborn. He's like, oh, do you want to give little Levi a cuddle? And I'm like, yeah, that'd be great. So he hands it to me like this. And right at that critical point of no return, just as I grab the kid, what does it do? Projectile bullets. Oh, my jacket, all over my back. You know, that like super acidic, milky thing, it's like yogurt. You know it. And I was just like, oh, yeah, just take it back, you know, it's cute, whatever, but, you know, no thank you, it's fine. But it's kind of different, though, with my nieces and nephews. Because when they vomit on me, I'm like, oh, it's fine. You're cute. It's fine. And then the other day, they thought it was really funny because I had colds, and they thought it was hilarious to grab my jeans and wipe the snot on it. And I'm like, oh, that's cute, that's alright, that's fine. It's such a different thing that we're willing to love when we share that Father, isn't it? And the sad truth of life is that sometimes brothers and sisters in Christ vomit on us, don't they? You know, and sometimes we also vomit on them as well, to be fair. But when we share a Father, we love and we forgive because we love our Father that we share with our Father. We love our Father. And there's a beautiful little equation here, isn't it? It says, love the Father equals love for the child. And then John kind of reverses it and says, well, love for the child equals loving your Father. So when you love and when you live in a community that supports and loves one another, you're actually loving God. You're loving the Father that we all have in common here. I've got friends on Facebook that aren't very pro-God, shall we say. And I think we live in a culture that is not always the warmest towards Christianity. And they love to find those stories of people protesting and doing things that don't look particularly loving. And sometimes my question for those kind of believers, again, the idea of being born again, I think of some redneck with a pitchfork on. That kind of an image. He's angry, protesting, things like that. And the question is, you know, what do we do with that? How do we understand some of these images? And I think a question for each one of us is, well, how we live will reflect who we think our Father is. You know, we have those common traits that my nieces and nephews kind of have a motherish look about them. So we're going to look like our Father. And so if our picture of our Heavenly Father who has begotten us, if we're His children, we're going to look like Him, but also that kind of image that we have. So if our picture of our Father is this angry guy just ready to condemn and judge, then that family trait is going to be in us as well. So we're going to be ready to and to judge. But there's kind of a, this picture of father is so important because it's not the angry judge or defender. Yes, of course. Is he holy? Absolutely. Does he judge? Absolutely. But it also is a father who disciplines in the context of love and of relationship. Therefore, if we have a loving, caring father, we'll have that family trait of love and of grace, which is how we are known as his disciples, because we love one another. We're going to look like him. We're going to share that family trait. So Jesus brings rebirth, he brings love, and he brings victory. Jesus brings victory, verses 4 to 5. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. So who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So we're talking victory. This is John's journey with Jesus and his understanding of who he is in light of Jesus. So where else has John heard Jesus speak of conquering and of victory and of overcoming? Well, many times, but I think particularly again in the upper room. John 16:33. He says, what a pep talk, in this world you will have trouble. And I've spoken these things to you so that you'll have peace. But in this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. I've conquered, I've had victory over the world. And there's this little word, nike, in Greek, which is victory, conquering, defeat. It's the same concept. And there's kind of a little bit of wordplay in here that we'll get to in a second, but it's that whole idea of victory that I think shadows some of Jesus' previous thoughts and what he said about conquering and victory. When he's in the upper room and says, take heart, there's some grammar that we just need to consider here. It says, in the world, you, second person plural, you will have trouble, but take heart, I, first person singular, have overcome the world. You will have trouble, take heart, I overcome the world. So it's kind of, for a minute there, you kind of feel a bit of pain, don't you? Well, when I left Birmingham, just a few weeks back to come over here, the flight was massively turbulent. It was just insane. Over the speaker, he kept saying, oh, please put on your seatbelt, it's going to be a lot of turbulence. And so I had my seatbelt on for like 5 hours, I had to go to the toilet. It was not the best journey ever. It was just up and down. It kept saying, yeah, put the seatbelt back on, no worries. So imagine you're on this massively turbulent flight with me. And over the loudspeaker, the captain says, if you could just remain seated, fasten your seatbelts, because there's going to be a lot of turbulence. But don't worry, I've got a parachute. You're like, do I have a parachute? No. I have a parachute. Now you've got a seatbelt. So you can just crash, but don't worry, I've got a parachute. You're like, I'm not cool with that, sorry, Captain. I want a parachute too. And in a slight sense, before there's further clarification of death and the resurrection of Jesus, he's kind of said, well, I've got a parachute, you've got a seatbelt, so enjoy the turbulence that you're going to face on this wonderful life. But it's not left there, is it? What does it say? Why everyone born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he that believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus has a parachute, and we believe, we grab onto him. Now we share a parachute with Jesus. Why is it first person singular, my parachute? Because it's his, he won it. He won the victory. It wasn't a victory that we won. But when in faith we are reborn and we join with Christ, we cling on to Him. And His parachute saves us. His does. What is this little word play I mentioned before about Nikkei, this word of conquering? It's difficult to sort of convey in English, but to put it like this. Everything born of God is victorious over the world, and this is the victory which is victorious over the world, our faith. It's our faith or belief that makes us victorious. Faith or belief in what or in whom? In Jesus, the Son of God, with whom we share a parachute. And at the end of verse 5, it kind of loops back. Who overcomes the world, the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, right? You're His child. You are begotten. You're back at the beginning. And this kind of victory is way more than just eschatological. Again, as we've been singing about when Christ returns, it's way more than that. It's a present victory. It's a victory over the power of sin right now, and it's a real spiritual victory, isn't it? It's not just an idea, it's not just a theory or a concept, but it's a very real spiritual power from our new source of being born again. I have this friend in Birmingham called Sam, and one day Sam was walking through this park, and as he passed by, he saw a guy sitting on a park bench there. And as he was walking, my friend Sam felt like what was saying. That guy's name is Daniel. It's Daniel, like Daniel with the lions. And there's lions around him trying to devour and take him down. And Sam was like, I was going to go. But he couldn't let it go. God kept saying this to him. So eventually he must have his courage and went back, went over to the park bench and said, "This might sound a bit crazy, but what are the chances? Is your name Daniel?" And the guy said, no, it's not. And he went, "Oh, okay, sorry, it was a bit awkward, but I just kind of felt like God was saying, your name is Daniel, and there are lions coming around to devour you." At which point this guy broke down and cried. And he said, "Actually, my name is Daniel, and there's a hit on me right now. Because I've been in some bad gang stuff, people trying to take me down. And I was just on my way to kill myself." And then my friend Sam was like, "Well, this is what this means. You feel like there's lions coming to devour you. But God is going to pull you out of this pit. He's taking you right out." And they prayed together. They shared about the work that Jesus has done. Now, Daniel has been part of our church for quite a few weeks now. He's understanding more and more who Jesus is. So much of this dark history that he's had has now been broken. Where has that power come from? Jesus Christ,
Amen.
Who is victorious.
Amen.
Daniel has clung to his parachute, and he's felt the victory over sin, not just at the end, but right now. Brought from darkness into life, right now. This is Jesus. That's it. Absolutely. Yeah. And isn't that demonstrated so much by that story of Sam and Daniel? Is that God has sent my friend Sam to Daniel to pull him out when he wasn't even expecting. He thought the lions were here. That is Jesus. What does John say? Jesus brings rebirth, brings love, brings victory. So where does this leave us this morning? What do we do with this? Well, maybe it is that we need rebirth. I have no idea where particularly any of your spiritual journeys are. Maybe you feel like my MacBook that was really just struggling to reboot and to keep going. Maybe you try going to the Apple computer store, but it just hasn't worked. You try the career or the relationships or the friendships, and just hasn't quite worked for you. Well, really, it's because what each one of us needs is to be reborn from above by believing that Jesus is the Christ. What does the Christ mean? means he was the one sent from God, anointed to forgive our sins. Because there was a punishment on us. But in the death of Jesus, the punishment was on his shoulders. When he rose again, he was victorious. For we believe in joy and victory, don't we? So maybe we need some more love. Maybe that picture that we have of God is much more of the angry, distant judge. Maybe you walk around perhaps with a sense of constant disappointment. Maybe God is just disappointed. Maybe we're not cool here. Maybe there's something wrong. And of course, sin creates a barrier. But if we believe in Jesus, what's happened to sin? It's gone. It's forgiven. Forgiven because of Jesus. Because of victory in his way. That's the part of that. We don't need to walk around with a sense of disappointment because of Jesus. Is that fair? No, it's not. That's what it's grace. Because we've not earned it, so of course it's unfair. That's why we feel like we don't deserve it, because we don't deserve it. We can walk in the freedom of the loving Father. Pleased with Jesus, therefore pleased with us. Maybe we need some of that victory that Jesus brings in our present struggles. In this world of sin, Jesus has won the victory, hasn't he? Again, it's a very real power. How do we encounter this? By encountering Jesus himself. I just urge you, if you are haven't read the Gospel of John for a while, pick it up, read it through this week. Read through it. Start to understand more and more of this Jesus that John loved and knew. And in knowing Jesus, we see more of his very real presence with us. When we know who's with us, we can have his victory over sin. I'm just going to pray as we close now. And we'll just pray for those three things. Maybe there's a rebirth that you need to receive Christ. I'm just going to pray that your heart will be open to see God by calling your name and saying, come to me. By believing in me, I can rebirth you. And then lastly, I'm just going to pray if maybe you need a new picture of God as a loving Father, not as a disappointed judge, that God would speak that loving aspect of his Father's heart into you. Do you want to join with me as we pray? Father God, how incredible that we can call you Abba, Dada, the little mumblings of a baby child. Dada, that's it. You cry it out exactly like that. That's how we can approach you, Father God. I ask if there is in any of our hearts a fracture because of sin and our own stubbornness, that you would forgive that in the name of Jesus. We say, yes, Jesus, you are the Christ who died and rose again for the forgiveness of my sin. Maybe that's something that we need to say this morning. If that's you, why don't you say it in your own heart, Jesus, I believe you are the Christ. You died and rose again for the forgiveness of my sin. The good news from that is that we are now your child of God. Fill our hearts with love for our brothers and sisters, even when they vomit on us, Lord God. You fill our hearts with love for one another, that we would know you as Father. And if there are people here that for whom the turbulence is very real, for whom the difficulty of life is very real right now, the temptation is very real, we call upon the name of Jesus for victory. A victory that you have won. That each and every one of us will know your Holy Spirit with us every day. Your very real presence who brings victory today. breakthroughs in your name, Lord Jesus, where there is darkness and we breathe life. Please, please do. And we just thank you so much for this family, for this community, that we can here call each other brother, we can call each other sister, because we share this Father. I ask for Cornerstone that people would know Cornerstone, your disciple, through their love. You would pour out your love, Lord Jesus. In your name we say, Amen.